was reminded of a book I'd been reading recently, which is an old book from the 1960s by Richard Hofstadter called Anti-Intellectualism in America. And it was interesting for me to read that because it was written in response to McCarthyism. It was written in 1961 or so. And I thought I'd begin to put this in context in a quote at the beginning of that book from 1961, where he quoted Emerson, who wrote, "Let us honestly state the facts. Our America has a bad name for superficialness. Great men, great nations have not been boasters and buffoons, but perceivers of the terror of life and have manned themselves to face it." So I thought I'd ask you to comment on that, and then we can move into recent politics.
Well, Emerson was a very interesting thinker, but in many respects, he unfortunately illustrated the things that he's criticizing.
I agree.
So take, for example, something not irrelevant today, his attitude toward the Civil War. At the very beginning, he was a pacifist. In fact, he was, in a sense, in favor of the war. He thought it would break down the states. It would break down state power, so maybe it would be beneficial. After the Battle of Bull Run, he became an enthusiastic super patriot, very much the way intellectuals do all the time. As soon as the conflict begins, we're enthusiasts for our own side. Mm-hmm. In fact, if you look back at the Transcendentalists, his group, some of the most distinguished intellectuals in the United States, certainly, maybe anywhere, one didn't go along with the tide, Nathaniel Hawthorne. Uh-huh. And he was kind of excluded. In fact, there's a very interesting article you might want to read if you haven't, in the Atlantic Monthly. Hawthorne, towards the end of the war, about 1864, decided to just travel through the South to see. By then, the outcome of the war was reasonably clear. Uh-huh. And he wrote an article which was supportive of the North, but skeptical. For example, he interviewed Southern prisoners of war in a fairly sympathetic way. He said, look, these are just rural farmers. They're not war criminals. They were brought up to defend their homes and so on. We should treat them decently. Anyway, the interesting thing about the article is not only his commentary, which is interesting, but the interpolations. Mm-hmm. The editors agreed to have it published, but only if they were allowed, and this is the liberal intellectual journal, if they were allowed to interpolate comments criticizing what he wrote along the way. Huh. So there you have Hawthorne's moderately sympathetic view to people who are defeated and suffering, and the liberal intellectuals interpolating, so no, you have to be a super patriot. You can't say these things. It's very instructive about intellectual history in many ways. In fact, if you look at the history of intellectuals, it works very much like this. So shortly after this period came the Dreyfus trial, mm-hmm. which actually is the first time that the word intellectual starts being used in its modern sense. And it's very interesting that today we honor the Dreyfus arts, Emil Zola and so on.
Sure.
Not then. They were bitterly attacked by the immortals of the Académie Française. How dare you mere writers and artists criticize our grand institutions, you know, the state, so on. Fast forward, Zola actually had to flee the country.
Yeah, sure.
Let's go forward to not long before we met, late 60s, uh-huh. 66, 67, roughly then. McGeorge Bundy, former Harvard dean, mm-hmm. leading intellectual, national security advisor for Kennedy and Johnson, had an article in Foreign Affairs, the main establishment journal, in which he said, he discussed the criticism of the Vietnam War. He said, yes, there are legitimate criticisms about the tactics and so on. And then there are what he called the wild men in the wings, people like Hawthorne and Zola, who are not only criticizing the tactics, but are raising questions about our motives.
I assume you were one of the wild men in the wings.
Oh, absolutely, very far out in the wings. And this is a theme that runs through basically all of history. You go back to classical Greece, who drank the hemlock? The guy who was corrupting the youth of Athens by asking too many questions.
Yeah.
Right up to the present. It's and so it's interesting to raise the question of Emerson, who was a very distinguished, honorable figure, but not immune.
Well, no, and I like that quote because of the many-sided aspects of it, because of his background, and also this notion, of course, great nations have not been boasters and buffoons, which sort of resonates in some ways in the current times. But this and this idea of whether anti-intellectualism it has been prevalent and to what extent it's good or bad.
It's a good question.
Yeah.
So, for example, there are several kinds of intellectuals. There's the wild men in the wings, and they're the what are sometimes called the stenographers of power.
Yeah.
And one has to make up one's own mind, but I think you can certainly have different attitudes towards them.
Well, you know, we were talking about lunch that I learned from you when the first time we met, which was when I was sitting in a course in American foreign policy when I was a student at MIT, a shocking fact, which to me just surprised me because I'd always kind of revered academia and it's been a part of my life ever since. But the realization that in some ways during the Vietnam War, the last group to accept the immorality of that war were the academics, which I always thought, maybe because I knew of you, but I'd always thought somehow the academics were leading it, but it was the students, it was the public. Maybe you can go into a little bit.
Well, I would broaden it beyond academics to the general intellectual community, with some exceptions. There always are the
sure.
Emil Zolas and yes. the Nathaniel Hawthorne.
And the Noam Chomskys.
And others. But by and large, it's true. In fact, you get a kind of a vivid picture of it. Well, first of all, remember that opposition to the war was very late in coming. The war actually started in the early 50s. By 1960, maybe 60 or 70,000 people had been killed in South Vietnam mm-hmm. just by the repressive government we were supporting. Kennedy escalated the war in 1961 and 62. He authorized the U.S. Air Force to start bombing rural South Vietnam under South Vietnamese markings, but nobody was fooled.
Uh-huh.
Authorized napalm. Began, and this was very serious, chemical warfare to destroy crops and livestock to try to drive the rural population into concentrated areas called strategic hamlets where they were being protected against the guerrillas who the U.S. government knew very well they were supporting. We know this from internal documents that have been released. There was no protest, none.
None.
In fact, just to give you an example, when 1965, I guess, I was 64, 65, I happened to be spending a year at Harvard as a visiting fellow in Cognitive Science Center. February 1965, the war against South Vietnam had already half destroyed the country, but the U.S. escalated the war to the north. And the individual who was primarily responsible for this was McGeorge Bundy,
uh-huh.
National, you recall, after yeah. Pleiku and so on.
Yeah.
A couple of students, Bundy was being invited, had been invited to be the commencement speaker at the June commencement for Harvard. And a couple of students initiated a very mild petition asking whether it's right to invite someone who's just launched a war against another country without provocation. Since I was there, they asked me to see if I could get some faculty signatures. Virtually impossible. That was 1965. By that time, the war was already far advanced. In fact, in October 1965, there was an International Day of Protest. You were probably in elementary school at the time, so you didn't know about it.
Yeah, I was still in elementary school and in Canada, that which also made it.
But it was an International Day of Protest.
Yeah. It's interesting because, you know, so this was 65. Yeah, because one thinks of the protests as being later, of course, but already, and maybe the American media, maybe you're going to get
well,
there.
Well, what happened is interesting. I'm talking about Boston, maybe the most liberal city in the country.
Yeah.
We decided to try to have a demonstration in Boston to join the international demonstrations.
Uh-huh.
We went to the Boston Common, you know, the standard place.
Sure.
I was supposed to be one of the speakers. totally broken up by counter-demonstrators, mostly students, incidentally, coming to smash up this demonstration. The Boston Globe, maybe the most liberal paper in the country, you look at the front page the next day, it was denouncing the demonstrators. How dare you? Very much like the immortals of the Académie Française, how dare you attack our noble institutions and so on. This is October 1965. By then, there was another international day of protest in May, in March, I think, 1966. We decided we can't have a public meeting. We'll have a meeting in the church, Arlington Street Church. Church was attacked.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, Vietnam had literally almost been destroyed. At that, just to give in, Bernard Fall, who was the most respected military historian, Vietnam expert, no dove, incidentally, but cared about the Vietnamese. He wrote at that time that he doubted that Vietnam would survive as a cultural and historical entity under the most serious attack that had ever been launched against an area that size, words roughly like that. That was at the point when we, in liberal city of Boston, we couldn't have a demonstration in a church without it being attacked. Well, after that, finally, an opposition movement developed, mostly young people, students, and so on. But let's fast forward up to 1975, when the war ended. As soon as the war formally ended, of course, everyone had to write about it.
Yeah, yeah.
What did it mean? And you look across the spectrum of public opinion, expressions, public media, major media, and they kind of break up into the hawks and the doves. So roughly the hawks saying we were stabbed in the back, we didn't fight hard enough, if we'd fought harder, we could have won, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
The doves are always much more interesting. They set the kind of limits of possible thought, this far, but not a millimeter farther. So you go way to the end, say Anthony Lewis of the New York Times, strong critic of the war,
civil libertarian.
A very interesting article. He said the war began, he said, with blundering efforts to do good. Blundering because it didn't work. To do good because that's a tautology.
Yeah.
You don't give arguments for that. That's kind of like saying 2 + 2 = 4.
Yeah.
He's not a wild man in the wings.
Yeah.
You know? So he said by 1969, it was clear that it was a disaster. We could not bring democracy to Vietnam at a cost acceptable to ourselves. So it was really a terrible mistake. Now, up to the present, about as far as you can go to the critical side is to say it was a mistake. Very interestingly, at that point, public opinion was being carefully sampled. The Chicago Council on Foreign Relations does extensive studies of public opinion, very scholarly.
Mm-hmm.
They're 1965, 66, roughly then. Their report also, of course, asked questions about what you think about the Vietnam War, and the answers were interesting. About 70% of the population said it was not a mistake. It was fundamentally wrong and immoral. Now, that question kept being asked for another 15 years or so, up to about roughly 1990. The answers were all approximately the same. They stopped asking it after a while.
Yeah.
The last time they asked it, the distinguished social scientist, serious social scientist who was in charge of the surveys, John Reilly, asked the question in the comments, what do people mean when they say this? And he said, well, what they mean is too many American lives were being lost. Well, that's possible.
You know,
would have been possible to find out by asking another question.
Exactly.
But the other possible answer, namely they meant what they were saying, is just unthinkable.
Totally discounted. You know,
this is the history of intellectuals.